Good morning, everybody. Dr.Greenbeard here for another session of reading with Dr.Greenbeard. And today we're going to be reading How to Supercharge Your Garden. It's the new Millennium edition. It has information by Graham Reinders. It was compiled and illustrated by Marcine Mainley. How to Supercharge Your Garden. New Millennium Edition. Once again, with information by Graham Reinders, compiled and illustrated by Marcine Mainley, published in beautiful British Columbia, Canada. Introduction to Supercharging Your Garden. Do you need this book? This book on supercharging a garden is for those who wish to increase their to a must-know set of facts that is easy to read. The techniques of supercharging your garden are simple. But a working knowledge of plants and what they need is essential to achieve maximum results of these techniques. This book will explain the workings of plants, how to root cuttings for production, and how to grow plants for super production. The first and most important question that a reader might ask is, what will I get out of this book? Here is a contemporary answer. Your input times your efficiency times your investment equals your results. Input, efficiency, and investment are the factors that produce results. The lack of any one factor can be compensated by the other two, but the lack of any two is insurmountable. Preface. Most people know how to plant an average garden, but some specific knowledge is needed to grow a supercharged garden. Most gardening books present the minimum requirements for plants to grow. This book presents the maximum requirements for plants to reach ultimate growth. It is written specifically for people who are already gardening and who wish to know how to supercharge their gardens and to update themselves with changes in the industry. Published research is lagging behind the practical applications of supercharged gardens. There are many advanced indoor garden systems in everyday use, like the one shown on pages 108 and 109. They are yielding enormous quantity of herbs, vegetables, fruits, flowers, and inflorescences that are superb in quality. This book on supercharging a garden is aimed at ultimate vegetable, fruit, herbal, or inflorescence production. Plants can produce many times their regular yields when supercharged. This book tries to explain many things from the plant's point of view. It would be advisable to read the other beginner books to get a basic overview of what has gone before. For beginner gardeners, The Best of the Growing Edge is a wonderful guide. Soilless growing is an important part of this book, but the other knowledge is useful for all gardens. The essence of soilless growing is based on the maxim that the yield of any plant is dependent on the resources available to it. Hydroponics and aeroponics maximize resources to the roots. After you have read this book, you will be surprised by just how much you have learned without even realizing it. Many things that plants do will seem obvious once the reasons are understood. The aim is to show you why things work so you can get all parts of your garden system working together and not against each other. The information in this book has been summarized and interpreted from many sources. Some of the ideas presented are based on actual grower usage, but they work well and hopefully will soon be researched. All the matters discussed in this book are based on real working garden systems. Many ideas presented here are simplifications of extremely complex principles. Hopefully, the serious scientists would not be upset as a few liberties were taken when getting the high science simplified. There are now available several models of water-cooled lights which allow gardeners to increase the surrounding light densities around plants. Water-cooled HID lights are an advancement in a supercharged garden, and the advantages and disadvantages of their use are discussed in detail in this text. This publication on supercharging a garden presents workable ideas that can be applied by readers. However, it is stressed that the application of any of these ideas is solely the responsibility of the reader, and the adherence to regulations, building codes, or overriding state, provincial, or federal laws is left entirely up to the reader and user. When you have finished reading this book, you should be able to take the ideas discussed here and create a high-yield, supercharged garden that is state-of-the-art. It should bring you many hours of happy gardening. Finally, many thanks to Graham Reinders for contributing valuable information to this book. The publisher, edited, 1999. All right, yeah, this is 1999. I can tell you that the water-cooled lights are a thing of the past now, okay? But moving right along into our table of contents, we're going to go to chapter one. Chapter one, the plant. There are three classes of plants, and they metabolize in three different ways. The succulent plants are called CAM, C-A-M. They are low light and high humidity plants that do well indoors in kitchens and bathrooms. The hot arid climate plants are called C4. These are mostly grasses. They have very efficient ways of using CO2 and sunlight. Most of our favorite plants, which will be discussed in this book, are called C3. They join two 3-carbon atoms together to make sugar, which is 6 carbons, 6 hydrogens, and 6 oxygens stuck together. How a plant works. Like humans, plants live and breathe 24 hours a day. To make energy, every plant cell respires, quote, when plant sugar is converted to energy. The plant uses oxygen, O2, and breathes out carbon dioxide, CO2. Just as energy moves in the human body, plant sugars, waters, and nutrients are continually being transported within the plant body. First, the leaves create a circular flow with the roots. The leaves of a plant draw up water from the roots through straw-like cells in the stem called xylem. The leaves evaporate water all the time to draw up more water from the roots, and this creates the water pressure that keeps the whole plant rigid and stops it from drooping and wilting. The leaf sends sugar solutions down to the roots in separate straw-like cells called phloem. In the same way, the roots exchange nutrients for sugars with the leaves. This liquid cycle is continuous and is further explained in the next page on the roots. Parts of the plant. For the purpose of this book, you need only to be concerned with the three main parts of the plant: the roots, the stems, and the leaves. They are all important, and a problem in any one of them is a major one. The roots are the most sensitive and the most difficult to observe when trouble starts. The roots. The magic chemistry of plant growth starts at the roots. The roots send nutrients, in exchange for sugar, up through the leaf stems to the leaves for final processing. They are also large storage sites for excess energy from the leaves, which is stored as starch. The roots and their capacity to store starch will decide how well a plant will grow and how much the plant will yield. Root size. A research rye plant in a 12-inch pot had 14 billion root hairs that, if placed end-to-end, would have stretched 6,200 miles, almost 10,000 kilometers. The root hairs alone would have covered a square area of 180 feet by 180 feet. That's 55 meters by 55 meters. The more extensive the root system, the better the plant will grow. This is because roots storing much energy are able to exchange lots of nutrients up to the leaves, and so the leaves can send down more sugar, etc., etc. Thus, root growth is directly affected by the moisture, oxygen, temperature, and sugars sent down from the leaves. Root medium. Root medium is important for plant growth. The less energy the roots use to absorb water and nutrients from the surrounding medium, the more they can use that energy to grow and to help send nutrients up to the plant. Most of the plant's water is taken in by the root hairs. 99% of the water taken in by a plant is transpired out through the leaves. A plant will fall over and wilt as a result of its roots not being able to extract any more water from the surroundings. Air roots. In a plant's natural life in the earth, its roots get moisture from rainfall. After rain, the soil water soon sinks down and the topsoil dries quickly. For this reason, the top one-third of plant roots are air-specialized, and the bottom one-third are water roots. One must be careful not to keep the air-specialized roots constantly wet, or the plant will drown. The bottom section of roots can be constantly wet, provided that the water has oxygen in it. Stagnant water will soon kill the plant. The roots should always look crisp and white. If the roots develop brown tips or general browning, the problem is usually lack of oxygen, and infection will soon follow. A plant can function quite well with its roots exposed to light as long as they do not dry out. However, the light encourages algae growth, which causes odors, and the algae competes with the plant for nutrients in the light period and the oxygen in the dark period. Oxygen. Oxygen is the most important root requirement because the roots need oxygen to convert sugar to energy. The more oxygen available to the roots, the more energy they can transfer to the plant. Temperature. Temperature also affects root growth and function. The roots do a great deal of their storage developing at night when the green sections of the plant are not being pressured by the light to produce and distribute day's excess sugar to the roots. Roots function more efficiently when they are in warm. So roots in warm dark period develop better structures than those grown in cool dark period. As an illustration, a cycle of warm dark, 77 degrees Fahrenheit, 25 degrees Celsius, and day, 59 degrees Fahrenheit, 15 degrees Celsius, would develop better roots than a cycle of cool dark, 59, and a day, 77. In essence, plants will grow better with a high average 24-hour root temperature that is constant rather than fluctuating. Supercharged roots. The root hair zone is relatively small and starts just behind the growing root cap. This zone advances with the growing roots, and as the new hairs near the tip emerge, the older hairs die off. Here is where most water and nutrients are absorbed. So for supercharged growth, plant roots must not be allowed to become root-bound, but be kept healthy and advancing at maximum throughout the entire life of the plant. When growing in pots that are too small, it is better to have the roots trim themselves by coating the inside of the pots with special copper paint rather than letting the roots circle and girdle themselves. In general, pots are not oxygen efficient for super plant growth. Remember that plant yield is proportional to root size. The stems. The stems serve as supply pipes between the roots and the leaves. Shorter stems are better because the nutrients have less distance to travel between the roots and the leaves. This affects the whole plant since it does not have to lift the water too high. The plant conserves energy. That energy can then be used for extra yield. The leaves. The leaves are the sugar energy producing factories of the plant. They produce plant sugars by using light to combine water and nutrients with carbon dioxide from the air. Provided that the leaves have adequate light and enough CO2, the air has roughly 400 parts per million on average, the plant will grow well. You should read the section on The Magic Is Here, Photosynthesis in Chapter 3, where the workings of the leaves are described in detail. Don't worry, we'll get to that. Continuing on with the leaves. To let in CO2, leaves have on their underside breathing holes called stomata. Stomata are on the underside for obvious reasons. A, they remain shaded. B, dirt does not settle on them and block them. C, fungal spores do not settle into them. There could be from 20,000 to 40,000 of these small holes in an area equal to a thumbnail. Only in the light do leaves produce sugars and starches, which become the energy for the plant. Good leaf growth provides lots of sugar energy for the plant. As mentioned before, evaporation at the leaves causes water to be drawn up from the roots. In this way, the leaves exchange sugars for nutrients with the roots. Good leaf growth makes it possible to draw up lots of nutrients and have lots of excess sugars to send down to the roots. However, the yield of a plant is not directly proportional to the amount of leaves it has. The leaves are only the plant's potential. The roots are far better indicators of the energy produced. Supercharged leaves. The leaves are constantly sending out energy to the plant and to the roots when supercharged. They are kept at an absolute maximum production. The leaves are now processing so much starch that they have to store a great deal of it in their tissues. At night, the leaves transfer as much stored energy as possible to the roots. The healthier the leaves and the stems are, the more energy they have to transfer into storage within the plant. The leaves are the visible part of the plant, and the health of the plant can be easily seen in them. Leaves do not repair themselves, so the life of a plant can be read by its leaves. Regular gardening books can explain how various nutrient deficiencies can be identified when examining the plant leaves. Note, the shorter in height which a plant can be maintained, the easier it is for the plant to transfer energy between its leaves and roots. This is the starting principle of achieving an efficient, productive plant. Building long stems uses a lot of energy that could have been used for creating yield. The leaves at the top of the plant tend to supply the top growing shoots. The leaves at the bottom of the plant tend to supply the roots. The middle of the leaves can go either way as the demand changes. During flowering and fruiting, only the very bottom leaves supply the roots, and the rest of the leaves try to get as much energy as possible to the flowers or fruits. For this reason, the more leaves are unshaded and in good light, the more chance the plant has of creating extra storage of energy that will ultimately go into yield. Therefore, never strip any section of a plant of all of its foliage, because there should always be plenty of leaves collecting light. The bottom leaves should never be removed if they are healthy, because they are the main root suppliers and do not shade any important sections of the plant. Older yellowing leaves should be removed because they are not doing much work. When deciding which greenery to keep on the plant, always give preference to the younger leaves because they are still functioning at 100% efficiency. A simple theory of plant growth. To supercharge your garden, you must understand some of the workings of plant life. The simple theory of plant growth in this book involves plant hormones, plant stresses, plant rhythms, light cycles, plant energy, induced flowering, bushing, plant spacing, and internode length. Plant hormones. Botanists have identified five hormones in plants. All five have complex functions. They are simplified as follows. A, auxins, develops in leaf buds and leaves. B, gibberellins, develops in shoot buds and seeds. Cytokinins, develops in root tips. Ethylene, gas, develops generally in any plant cells. Abscisic acid, develops in mature leaves. There is a constantly changing relationship between the activities of these hormones and a plant's stages of development. Auxins. Auxins are produced mainly in the buds and leaves of the plant. Auxins, rooting powders, and gels are synthetic auxins, stimulate plant cells to grow longer, especially at the shoot and root tips where the highest auxin concentrations are. New roots need auxins to get started, and shoot tips need auxins to keep growing. The higher the concentration of natural auxins, the better the root and shoot tip cells will grow. For some unexplained reason, auxins will gravitate to the bottom side of a horizontal branch or stem and cause the cells on the bottom of the branch or stem to elongate faster than on the top side. Consequently, that branch or stem will grow curving up until it is close or to being vertical and pointing to the light. Sometimes a cutting or clone taken from a horizontal branch has this mechanism disrupted by the cut. Subsequently, it never gets the message to grow up vertical again, even after it gets older. Also, for some unexplained reason, auxins act more on the shady side of the shoots. This auxin accumulation on the shady side of the shoots causes the cells on the shady side to elongate more than the cells on the lighted side, and so the shoots grow curving towards the light. The auxins also accumulate at the top of the growing shoots, and this causes the plant to keep advancing upwards where the auxins have accumulated. Apical dominance. The auxins in the main shoot have the ability to slow growth on all the shorter shoots surrounding it. When the main shoot advances away from its surrounding shoots, the shorter shoots will again start growing as the auxin concentration in that dominant shoot gets further away and weaker in effect. If a dominant shoot is pinched off, its auxin concentration is redistributed to the shorter shoots around it, And so these shoots start to grow larger. In cuttings, the auxins must be redirected from the shoots to the root beginnings for the roots to start growing. Rooting gels and powders are used on cuttings to promote this new root growth. Be careful when applying the gels and powders. Too much auxin placed on cuttings actually stops plant roots from developing. Apply the weakest possible root gel or powder. It must all be gone within a few days or the roots will not grow. Gibberellins. Gibberellins promote extra long and fast cell growth between the nodes of the plant. Gibberellins are also light-sensitive hormones, but they are opposite to auxins in that light slows cell stretch under the control of gibberellins. A way internode lengths can be kept short is with high light intensities. Low light is one of the main reasons why plants stretch. See Controlling Internode Lengths on Indoor Plants, pages 27 and 28 for other reasons. Gibberellins are also involved in the stimulation of flowering, the breaking of dormancy, and seed grow signals. Cytokinins are hormones that influence how fast and how often plant cells divide. Some products sold for plant enhancement contain cytokinins, which are often extracted from seaweed. Seaweed is a marine algae, and the marine algae contain natural cytokinins. Coconut milk also contains a cytokinin. Cytokinins are used to kickstart leaf and shoot growth. Do not overapply it or the auxin hormones will be disrupted. Cytokinin concentrations stop rooting. Therefore, do not put any cytokinin or seaweed products near cuttings or clones that are rooting. Dominance of these three hormones, auxins, gibberellins, and cytokinins in a plant keeps the plant growing in a vegetative and youthful stage. Ethylene. Ethylene, C2H2 gas, is present in most plant tissues. It is produced in cell concentrations in response to stress and age. It causes fruits to ripen, leaves and flowers to age, and leaves and fruits to drop. Abscisic acid is also part of the aging process. It controls seed development and causes the stomata to close under water stress. Dominance of these two hormones, ethylene and abscisic acid, in a plant leads to aging and seed preparation. How these five hormones do all the things that have to be done to grow a plant is still not well understood. Plant stresses. Stress in plants is caused by imbalances in the plant chemistry. In general, plant stress disrupts the normal chemical reactions happening within the plant and causes ethylene to start developing in the cells. A plant likes to have an average day with no surprises on any day of its life. Any unusual event in the plant's life will change its internal chemistry and result in slow growth. Some stress causes are: 1. Water stress. There is a lack of water or too much water for the plant. The water stress in plants causes abscisic acid to build up and closes down the stomata. Nutrient stress. There is too much, too little, or an imbalance of nutrients. This can attract diseases or nematodes, a kind of slender worm that disrupts root function. Mineral stress. It is caused by mineral imbalance in plant tissues, usually due to nutrient problems or by adding to recirculating mixes. This causes plants' growth to slow. By the time the results are visible, the problem is already very advanced. It usually takes a week to recover from mineral stresses. pH stress. The pH of the nutrient solution is changing all the time as the plant uses the minerals and the surrounding nutrients and as the water is transpired by the leaves and evaporates from the nutrient solution. Wildly fluctuating pH will reduce the plant's nutrient uptake. Age stress. As the plant gets older, its nutrient needs change. A tissue analysis will show the plant using totally different quantities of each nutrient as it ages. In highly supercharged garden systems, the nutrient fed to plants is different for each week of growth. Mature or aging plants need far less nutrients. Irregular light cycles. These will change the hormonal balance in plants that use the length of light and dark to tell when to flower. Plant damage. Any damage causes the plant to change its chemistry to repair the damaged site. Root damage, either physical or chemical, causes the plant to divert its chemistry to keep the roots advancing and creating new root hairs to absorb water. Roots cannot actually rebuild themselves when damaged. They just seal off the damaged section and advance around it. Environmental extremes and diseases. These can cause a plant to age and flower prematurely or a female plant to produce viable seeds without being fertilized or just cause poor growth. A note about unfertilized female seeds. Some female plants, if they are flowering in the absence of male plants, will create viable seeds if they are severely stressed. This happens because nature is ensuring the continuation of these plants. The seeds will be female and totally identical to the mother. Therefore, it is a good idea to treat flowering plants very well as they mature so as not to stress them and to cause them to waste energy by premature seeding. Vitamin B1, called thiamin, is the natural catalyst in the inner workings of the plant. One tends to treat plant stress with an application of vitamin B1, which appears to stabilize the plant chemistry. Vitamin B1 acts as a catalyst that makes all the plant enzymes work their chemistry smoothly again. All the trade names mix up their own special brew of vitamin mix. Some add vitamin B6, some add nicotinic acid, which may stimulate growth. Some add many other vitamins, which may be of other benefits to the plant. Plant rhythms. Plants have definite internal rhythms just as humans do. The plant's clock is reset each day by the light and the dark periods and the relationship between them. The daily rhythms of light and dark times, temperature, age, and stresses change the balance between the five hormones in the plant. The dark cycle is very important to plants. Respiration, this is when plants are making energy from sugar and oxygen, continues in the dark but at a much slower pace, almost independent of available oxygen because the leaves are not making oxygen in the dark. In the dark, there is a shift from leaf production to root production as the leaves transfer excess stored energy down to the plants and to the roots. Therefore, some dark time allows for better root structures. The experimental root growth 10 days after cutting graph on page 33 shows that giving plants a 24-hour light cycle is not the way to supercharge root growth. Plant energy. The indoor gardener has direct control over how a plant will use its energy. It is important for the grower to note that a plant wastes precious energy in the following ways. A tall plant has to build extra stem and then use extra energy to move the water up higher. B, an untrimmed bushy plant causes the plant to expend energy to build elaborate branch and leaf systems, and then even more energy to supply these structures. Careful trimming removes the unnecessary branches and suckers, shoots springing up from a root or underground stem, and this leaves more energy for yield. Get as many of the suckers and bottom branches off as possible. The suckers and shoots are called sinks because they use a lot of energy. The leaves are called sources because they are making energy. Trim mostly the leaves that are showing signs of age, dull color, and yellowing. Remove also any brown spotted leaves that have pests or pest damage. Excessive leaf trimming and branch cutting causes the plant to use extra energy to repair itself. Trimming causes the plant to mobilize its local chemistry to heal the wounds inflicted. This is an energy loss and a stress. Nevertheless, trimming has to be done from time to time. The longer a plant is left untrimmed, the more plant matter has to be removed at one time and the greater the damage that has to be repaired. Here are some trimming points to be aware of. Never make the plant bleed. Seal off any large wound. When trimming small succulent shoots and leaves, do not do a clean cut. Rather, make a pinch by indenting with the thumbnail so as to pinch the internal tubes in the shoot and leaves. To be really picky on larger shoots, pinch them till they fall over. Let them flop till the end of the day, by which time the wounds will have healed themselves, and then remove them. Remember that every time you cut through any part of the plant, you expose the inside of the plant to fungi and bacteria. D, poor growing medium, causes the plant to use extra energy to explore for nutrients and oxygen, and then makes the plant struggle to extract nutrients and oxygen out of the medium. High PPM and nutrient salt buildup causes the roots to fight against osmotic pressure and surface tension to extract water. Root fungi and rot causes the roots to sacrifice cell energy to fight them. Viruses, bacteria, or insects cause the plant to sacrifice enormous number of cells to isolate them. Many fungicides and chemical bug killers are phytotoxic, which means they kill plant cells. The warmer it is when these are applied, the greater the plant damage. It is better to not have to resort to these measures. Keep everything clean and dry and painted. All right, we're going to wrap it up right there. That's 30 minutes for today. We're going to pick back up tomorrow with induced flowering in plants. So that was 30 minutes of how to supercharge your garden. We got our way through most of chapter one, and we will pick right up and continue there with tomorrow's reading. I hope you enjoyed this, and I hope to see you back tomorrow to continue to supercharge your garden.